Your campaign of terror, murder, mayhem will not be tolerated any longer.
That is reassuring coming from Donald Trump this morning. Now, we've been waiting since last night when Iran struck two bases where American military personnel were operating to see what he would have to say. And he did say some things. He tried to say a lot of things. And I will say, we're gonna go through some specifics, JR and I. I will say that overall, there are worse speeches he could have given.
Okay.
I mean, as small of a person as he is, as cruel and xenophobic a person as he is, he could have simply said, yeah, no, we're sending everyone. We're sending a million troops. That could have happened. And so I think that a lot of the media is rushing to give praise to a person who has become very talented in manipulating them into doing that. But that said, it could have been worse.
Yeah, it's true. And he hit the points that we would assume he would hit. So I mean, I guess there's no surprises in here, except for the fact that it wasn't as incendiary as he's prone to be.
Yeah. Yeah, it was slightly incendiary towards the Iranians. I would say it was more incendiary towards Barack Obama, as we'll get to. But there were a few pieces of good news in this. So let's go through a little bit of that. So the first quote we want to focus on, he said, "I'm pleased to inform you the American people should be extremely grateful and happy." I don't like the use of the word grateful there. "No Americans were harmed in last night's attack by the Iranian regime. We sustained no casualties. All of our soldiers are safe and only minimal damage was sustained at our military bases." So bit of good news number one is that Donald Trump's completely needless raising of tensions with Iran has not yet cost any American service members their lives. So that is a good bit of news.
Right.
Saying that we should be grateful, this didn't need to happen at all. I'm not grateful for any of this.
Grateful to whom?
I guess grateful that Iran, you know, and there's different interpretations of whether this was a somewhat failed attack or if this was a move that they made to give Trump a face-saving way to back off of tensions. People believe that that might be the case, regardless of what the case is. Thankfully, no one yet has been killed as a result of Donald Trump's adventures abroad.
Yeah, so I guess I'm still stuck on the grateful part. I mean, just I know it seems like a small deal, but just a better choice of words generally works when you're the president and you're making these announcements to the country and then about something everyone was on the edge of their seats trying to figure out what was going on last night. I mean, just I'm not sure if there's a way for him to do it or if they write for him a way to make sure that he feels okay with not saying, yeah, so it was a bit of a mistake. And luckily, we made it out without anything happening, and now we can go ahead and move on to maybe something else.
Which is sort of, at least how I'm taking the full situation. He also said Iran appears to be standing down, which is a good thing for all parties concerned and a very good thing for the world. So look, it is far from confirmed whether we are truly standing down, let alone Iran. I mean, after all, in the initial, like after he struck Soleimani, while hypothesizing how Iran might respond, overt, obvious military action was never the most likely consequence. It was far more likely that asymmetric, generally hidden or proxy attacks were going to be were more likely. Those are still entirely possible. Hopefully that does not happen, but that's still possible. But let's say just for hypothetically, this is the end of it. Okay, how do you respond to that? If we go back to the status quo, which was already unfortunately worse, in a number of different ways than under Barack Obama, because we had previously had the Iran nuclear accords, which he shredded for no reason whatsoever. Right. So if we're back to that status quo,
back to him after shredding the Iran nuclear
accords. Yes, but no actual war with Iran.
Well, something else has to be done. I mean, it's one of those things where you're content for the moment because of how bad it could have gotten. Things can always get worse. And I think there was a few generals that were on last night during coverage on different cable networks that were saying it's very easy to heighten into war, but then it's really tough to get out. So at least we haven't gotten to that point where there's a point of no return. There's this line and there's still a chance to return from which it seems like they're trying to shoot for. But even after that, we're not even forgetting, but we're ignoring the fact that the previous situation is what led to these tensions. It's not like, and again, I'm not saying it started there. We know there's been decades worth of tensions and proxy things that are happening and people claiming responsibility that maybe didn't necessarily have it or didn't originate with them. We know all that is happening. But at least at this point, you have to have some way to take it back from the biggest moments, which one of those was, of course, Trump coming in, ripping up those Iran, the deal.
Yeah.
So I don't know if we can buy enough time that gets discussed further or we get a chance to see his level of incompetence, because he has promises he made about building walls and tax relief for middle class Americans. All those things that he came in and said he was gonna do, that then after he did the opposite, claimed to accomplish them anyway. We're gonna see what that what the agenda will come after that. Mm. Will he change his mind on that? Absolutely not, he won't.
Yeah. And I think you get into one of two ways that I know that overall great news that he hasn't yet launched us into a full scale war. That's great. But two ways that we're not quite, things are not quite as stable or as safe as people are implying coming out of the speech. One is that status quo where he got us out of the deal that everyone seemed to agree that Iran was abiding by, it stopped them from developing nuclear weapons. They still are backing off of the restrictions on enrichment. That news came out a couple of days ago. We've had no reversal on that. That combined with Donald Trump, literally the first words he said in his address this morning was, Iran will never have a nuclear weapon, and thanks to me, they never will. Well, if he plans to stick by that, first of all, he doesn't actually care about that goal, because if he did, he would have left the deal in place. Totally. But they are now free to pursue nuclear weapons. And so if that is the justification for military force, it'll be necessary to stop them from developing nuclear weapons, that's still a possibility in the near future.
It's the only way you can approach it this way is to ignore reality. Because we saw the situation the way it was when the deal was still in place, and we see the situation afterwards. There was literal points that happened. Again, once the deal was put in place, you can complain about the money that was given and what the terms people use, left on a tarmac and piles of cash on the tarmac, come on. So those are visual clues to give cues, to give people reason to have disdain for something that had potential roots to work. Mm-hmm. And then so in order to back off of it, you have to be fed lies mm-hmm. and mischaracterizations of exactly what is happening. And that's probably gonna continue.
Yeah, now the other thing I think that makes us a little bit less stable than a lot of people are taking from this address is that he did announce that the US will be imposing additional economic sanctions against Iran. In his words, until they change their behavior. But I don't know how I or the Iranian government is supposed to interpret that, considering that the Iran deal took off previous economic sanctions. The idea being that so long as they abided by the terms of the deal, they would not be sanctioned. Well, they did abide by the deal, and then they got sanctioned anyway. And so why would they change their behavior in this case? And I understand overall when people say that this is a de-escalation, I get what they mean in a military sense. But this is an economic escalation against Iran. Representative Ilhan Omar tweeted earlier today, this is economic warfare, that's what it is. People will die as a result of these sanctions, that is a thing that happens. And so this is not the worst sort of escalation, mm-hmm. but it's not a 100% de-escalation either. Iran still will likely feel that they need to respond in some fashion to what Trump has done today.
So now the questions that need to be asked every time either Mike Pompeo, Mark Esper, or Donald Trump gets in front of a camera is, what is the end game? What does that mean? As you already pointed out, what does it mean that Iran needs to stop its rogue actions, whatever term they use? Stop it to what degree? What are the parameter points? When it comes to conflicts and international conflicts overseas and potential military action, there are normal, conclusive, direct, specific things that probably need to be taken care of before things feel like they've lowered enough. Just say, until they stop. Until they stop what and when? Yeah. What are you talking about? So details need to be asked, and if they can't answer that question, we're gonna see how much they've really planned for this agenda.
And I'm gonna give one other warning too, because right now it seems like, okay, Trump seems satisfied, he feels like big strong guy, got what he wanted. But we know what Trump does. Trump says something like this, and then he goes home and he watches TV. And he dwells, and we'll see what he thinks about the news coverage that he gets as a result of this. I mean, remember, the bombing that killed Soleimani, that was apparently, according to insiders, according to New York Times reporting, that was a result of, he had previously announced those airstrikes that killed like 25 militia members. And it seemed like that was the response to the death of that American contractor. Mm-hmm. But then in the words of the insiders, he sat and he dwelled over the news coverage and then felt like he needed to do something more. And so he went with that option that stunned Pentagon officials. And so today, maybe he feels satisfied. But if he doesn't like the way that the media is covering this, who knows what might happen. And I will say for some of the media, if you've been watching Fox News over the past few days, most of them are not going to be happy with this development. Sean Hannity was calling for the full force of the US military to be used against Iran as of last night. Pete Hegseth was ecstatic at the possibility that culturally important sites would be destroyed. They were bloodthirsty, and maybe maybe they'll be placated with a so-called win for Donald Trump. Maybe that'll be enough. But they were hoping for something far more. And we know how influential some of them are. Yeah. Sean Hannity, Pete Hegseth, Fox and Friends, those are his closest advisors. So we'll see what effect they have over the next few days.
And also Laura Ingraham and Tucker Carlson, which in some points voiced some reservations about the situation. And maybe that's their approach, knowing that he listens to them as foreign policy experts. And like, hey, let's let him know that maybe that's not the best idea. But you have to phrase it in a way that makes it seem like only he benefits from making the move to back down. Yeah. Not from anyone else. It has to go back to being about him.
Thank you for watching this clip from The Damage Report. For more content from the show and access to TYT Network members only exclusives, go to tyt.com/Brooke. Wait, no, it's tyt.com/John. Go to tyt.com/John to sign up.